One of the things which set Brahms apart from most of his more romantic contemporaries, well, come to that, it set him apart even from his revered and beloved Schumann, was his obsession with what I can only call structural logic. It would be only a slight exaggeration to say that there isn't a single note in all the published works of Brahms that isn't there for a precisely articulated reason, precisely articulated in Brahms's own mind. In a fascinating conversation with his friend Georg Henschel, he spoke about the way a composition took shape in his head, and on one point he was not only emphatic but categorical.
There is no creating without hard work. That which you would call invention, that is to say, a thought, an idea, is simply an inspiration from above, for which I am not responsible, which is no merit of mine. Yes, it is a present, a gift, which I ought even to despise until I have made it my own by right of hard work. And there is no hurry about that either. When I have found the first phrase of a song, say, I might shut the book there and then go for a walk, do some other work, and perhaps not think of it again for months. If afterwards I approach the subject again, it is sure to have taken shape. I can now really begin to work at it. But there are composers who sit at the piano with a poem before them, putting music to it from start to finish until they arrive at the end and it's done.
And when Henschel asked for advice as to his own compositional practices, Brahms came back repeatedly to the same thing.
Let it rest. Let it rest and keep going back to it and working at it over and over again until it is completed as a finished work of art, until there is not a note too much or too little, not a bar you could improve upon. Whether it is beautiful also is an entirely different matter, but perfect it must be.
Now, from all this, you might well think that Brahms at work might have looked and sounded like Scrooge in Dickens's Christmas Carol, scratching away at his figures with an almost chilling detachment. Not so. Indeed, far from it. Our first witness is Brahms's friend and first biographer, Max Kalbeck.
Paying a morning visit to Brahms's house in the Salzburger Straße, I went up the outside steps, intending to come in by the wide-open back door, when I saw that the door of the music room was also open. At that moment, bewitching sounds came from the piano, which held me entranced on the doorstep. It sounded like free extemporization, but from the frequent repetitions of certain passages, I realized that Brahms was going through and improving and refining a new composition already complete in his head. He repeated the piece several times in individual sections, and eventually played it straight through. The solo changed into an extraordinary duet. The richer the shaping of the work became and the more passionately its delivery arose, the more strongly could be heard a strange growling, whining, and moaning, which at the peak of the musical ecstasy became sheer howling. Could Brahms, quite contrary to his inclination, have got himself a dog? After about half an hour, the playing and the howling stopped together. The piano stool was drawn back, and I entered the room. Not a trace of a dog. Brahms looked a little embarrassed and wiped his eyes with the back of his hand like a child who is ashamed. He must have wept violently, for teardrops hung in his beard and his voice sounded soft and unsteady. Soon afterwards he was heartily cheerful and in a jesting mood.
The second glimpse, also from Kalbeck, dates from the summer of 1880, the very year of the rift with Joachim, which Brahms spent at one of his favourite holiday haunts in Ischl in Switzerland. And the description in this case, down to the finest detail, could well be of Beethoven.
I suddenly saw a man running from the wood across the meadow towards me. I took him for a farmer. I was afraid I had been trespassing and was already reckoning on all sorts of unpleasant eventualities, when, to my joy, I recognized Brahms in the supposed farmer. But in what condition? What a sight! Bareheaded and in shirt sleeves, no waistcoat, no shirt collar, he brandished his hat in one hand, with the other dragged his cast-off coat in the grass behind him, and ran on quickly, as though hunted by an unseen pursuer. Already from far off I heard him snorting and groaning, When he came nearer, I saw how the sweat was streaming over his hot cheeks from the hair which hung about his face. His eyes were staring ahead into empty space and shone like those of a beast of prey. He appeared like one possessed. Before I recovered from my shock, he had shot past me so close that we almost collided. I immediately realized it was inadvisable to call to him. He was glowing with creative fire. I shall never forget that harrowing impression of elemental force.
But the most famous work to come from that summer wasn't of elemental force, let alone harrowing. It was Brahms at his most exuberantly high-spirited and entertaining, the Academic Festival Overture, written as a token of thanks to the University of Breslau, who had given him an honorary doctorate, and based almost entirely on German student songs.